Good morning, everyone, and welcome to worship. My name is Maestro Robert Nance. I'm the director of music here, if you didn't already know that. And it's my pleasure to share with you what our prelude is going to be like this morning. We have our bell ensemble primed and ready to go in the balcony, and they're going to play "It Is Well With My Soul." And after that, by way of an invitation to this afternoon's concert, we have Wagner Pastor and his wife Andrea Salazar, all the way from Ecuador, by way of Lexington, Kentucky, and now Fort Wayne. And you're in for a real treat, but they're going to offer the hymn that we're going to be singing at the end of the service in Spanish for us. And I'm thrilled with that. We're thrilled to have you here. Welcome. And so with that, let's get ourselves thinking about our service this morning with this wonderful bell prelude, "It Is Well With My Soul."
has venido a la orilla, no has buscado ni a sabios ni a ricos, tan solo quieres que yo te siga. Señor, me has mirado a los ojos, sonriendo, has dicho mi nombre. En la arena he dejado mi barca, junto a ti buscaré otro mar.
Tú sabes bien lo que tengo en mi barca, mayor a mi espaldas, tan solo redes y mi
pescador de otros mares, ansia eterna de almas que esperan, amigo bueno que así me llamas, Señor, me has mirado a los ojos, sonriendo, así es como
thank you so much to our bell choir and to Wagner and Andrea. We are so blessed here with so much musical talent. Amen.
Amen.
And good morning. Welcome to worship at Plymouth Congregational Church, United Church of Christ, here in Fort Wayne, Indiana. Please know that whether you are here in person or whether you are joining us online, no matter who you are, no matter where you are on life's journey, you and your questions are welcome here. Now, if this is your first time worshiping with us this morning, we offer you a very special welcome. We're very glad you're here, and we have a gift for you. I believe Vicki has the gift basket this morning, and she's back there. And so she'll be out front in the narthex at the end of the service. So if this is your first time and you'd like to get your welcome gift, just see Vicki, and she will give that to you. Also, a reminder that any pledges or donations can be placed in the basket at the front of the sanctuary. And for those of you who are watching online, you can give on our website at plymouthfw.org using the contribute button. And we are very thankful for all of you who are able to give and support the mission of Plymouth Church in whatever way is possible. Here at Plymouth Church, we are a church in covenant. Specifically, we have entered into four covenants together that guide our work as a congregation. We share those covenants together at the beginning of worship each week, first to let our visitors know a little something about who we are and what is important to us, as well as to keep our priorities and commitments ever before us. So first, we are an open and affirming congregation, offering a wide and radical welcome to all of our LGBTQ+ siblings, affirming that they are beloved children of God just as they are, and offering a safe space for all people to worship God and be in spiritual community together with others. We are a just peace congregation, meaning that we recognize that true and lasting peace in our world can never truly be achieved without first establishing justice. Therefore, we work and pray and advocate for both peace and justice for all who are oppressed, marginalized, left out, or left behind in our world. We are an Earthwise congregation, acknowledging the urgency of the climate crisis and the importance of our call to be good stewards of God's creation, not just for ourselves, but for seven generations and beyond. That stewardship includes things like environmental service projects, educational programming, and advocacy at the state and local level, and just recently, the introduction of a new compost system here at church. Finally, we are a global mission church, which means that we strive for all of our outreach and service and charitable work to be intensely local and intentionally global, serving and supporting those who are in need, whether it's through our food pantry in the parking lot or our Growing Hope Globally program, which helps farmers all around the world. Now, I have a couple of announcements, some things going on at Plymouth Church today and in the coming weeks. First, there are two things today that I want everybody to be aware of. First, after worship today, immediately after worship, our Knit and Kibitz group is holding their annual Knit and Kibitz sale. It's taking place in the Folsom Room right after worship. These are all handmade items by friends and members of Plymouth Church. It's a great way to get a head start on your Christmas shopping, and all of the money that is, all of the proceeds from the sale go to help families here in Fort Wayne through various nonprofit agencies. Also today, a little bit later on at 4 o'clock, please come and check out the next installment of our Plymouth Music Series. You heard Wagner and Andrea sing a little bit already this morning. You know how incredible they are, so come back at 4 o'clock, and they're gonna be giving a wonderful concert together, and there will be a reception afterwards, so come and enjoy that later on today at 4 o'clock. That is free and open to all. Our Centering Prayer Group has a new night. So we will be meeting now on the second and fourth Mondays of every month at 5:30 p.m., starting tomorrow night. So no experience is necessary. If this is something you've been curious about, I invite you to come join us tomorrow at 5:30 in the chapel and check it out. We have received our Christmas list from Fort Wayne Pride. And so evangelism and marketing is gonna have a tree up with all of the different gift options available. And that will be ready for by Tuesday of this week. So come on by anytime after Tuesday, grab a gift from the tree to go to an LGBTQ young person in need. This coming Saturday, at the Impact Center at 3 o'clock, there will be another teach-in on mass incarceration and the jail situation here in Allen County. Reverend Timothy will be leading that teach-in. So again, that's this coming Saturday at the Impact Center at 3 o'clock. So please come and join that if you are interested in what's going on with the current jail debate. Next Sunday, November 20th, immediately following worship, we will be gathering for our annual Hanging of the Greens. Yes, it is already that time of year. So we're gonna be putting up all of our Christmas decorations, we'll be putting up the Christmas tree, decorating the sanctuary. Many hands make light work, and it's always a very fun and festive time, so I hope many of you can stay after church next Sunday to help out with that. We are once again going to be hosting a Thanksgiving Day service and meal here at Plymouth Church. The service is going to be at 11:30 and the meal at noon. We are still looking for some folks to bring some of the dishes to complete the meal. So even if you can't stay, if you can come and drop off a dish, that would be very helpful. There's a sign-up sheet in the Folsom Room for that. Whew, okay. So that's all the announcements I have for this morning. If you want any more details on these or any other upcoming events, please do see your digital bulletin for more information. But now, finally, let us take a moment to center ourselves for worship. Let us take a moment to center ourselves, our minds, bodies, and spirits in God's presence. Let us be still and open ourselves to God's healing presence and action within and all around. Our call to worship this morning comes from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 43. But now, thus says our God, the one who created you, O Jacob, the one who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, and you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Do not fear, for I am with you. I will bring your offspring from the east, and from the west I will gather you. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from far away, and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. Our opening hymn this morning is number 407, How Firm a Foundation. Please rise in body or in spirit as we sing.
Yeah.
Let us pray. God of resurrection and liberation, during difficult times, we may fear that we are losing hope, or we may feel that our efforts for justice and peace are futile. As we come together today, remind us of the promise of your resurrection, and let that be the source of our courage and strength. Remind us that you are able to make a way where there is no way, and that nothing is impossible with you. Help us face the challenges and struggles before us with renewed energy and hope, knowing that you are always with us. We pray all of this in the name of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, may the peace of Christ be with you all. I invite you to rise and offer the sign of Christ's peace to one another. I would like to invite all of our children to come forward for the lighting of our peace candle.
As we all know, every day is a day to pray for peace, but today I ask you to join in the prayer on the green side at the bottom of the prayer cards. God of justice, bless those who work for peace through justice. Strengthen their resolve in the face of seemingly endless violence and oppression. Guide the leaders of the world, particularly in vulnerable places, to know your will and to support a just peace for all of your children. Amen.
this time, I'd like to invite all of our new members to come forward as we welcome them into our congregation. So just so all of you know who it is that we are welcoming today, I want to introduce our new members, starting here in the back row on my left is Keith Brockway, Amy Corson, Lydia Hernai, Dane Hernai, Garrett Pogue, Vicky Pogue, Jenna Rupp, and Nathan Rupp. Friends, today we rejoice in your pilgrimage of faith, which has brought you to this time and place. We celebrate your presence in this household of faith and ask you now to affirm your desire to become members of Plymouth Congregational Church.
We have a few questions for you, and so if you would please respond to this one, I do. Do you desire to affirm your baptism or be baptized into the faith and family of Jesus our Christ? If so, say I do.
Do you renounce the powers of evil and desire the freedom of new life in Christ? If so, say, I do.
Do you profess Jesus, our Christ, as Lord and Savior? If so, say, I do.
Do you promise by the grace of God to be Christ's disciples, to follow in the way of our Savior, to resist oppression and evil, to show love and justice, and to witness to the work and word of Jesus our Christ as best as you are able? If so, please say, I promise with the help of God.
Finally, do you promise according to the grace given you to grow in the Christian faith and to be a faithful member of the Church of Jesus our Christ, celebrating Christ's presence and furthering Christ's mission in all the world? If so, please say, I promise with the help of God. Let us pray. Gracious God, we praise you for gathering us into your church, the body of Christ in the world. We thank you for your people gathered in this local church and rejoice that you've increased our community of faith. Together, may we live in the Spirit, building one another up in love, sharing in the life and worship of the church, and serving the world for the sake of Jesus our Christ and his gospel of love, compassion, justice, and peace. Amen.
So we have some gifts for all of you to welcome you into our congregation this morning. Let us give our new members a warm Plymouth welcome.
Welcome, Garrett. Welcome, Keith. Welcome, Vicky. Welcome. And then Jenna, Lydia, Dane, Nathan. Welcome.
Let us be in an attitude of prayer. Loving and gracious God, we give thanks to you and offer you our prayers this day. We give thanks for those who have joined this congregation in collective discernment and our life together. May we learn from them as your Spirit moves in all of us. We thank you for extra days of warm weather we enjoyed earlier this week, and give thanks for the transition into early winter weather and snow now. We give thanks for the cycles of life in which we participate and rotate. We give thanks for all those who ran for elected office to serve us locally, at the state level, or federally. We pray for them and their families as some go through feelings of disappointment. We pray for those elected that they may use their positions for the common good, and celebrate all the volunteers, including poll workers, who dedicated many hours and who contribute to a democratic society. We give thanks for birthdays, anniversaries, and celebrations as well. And we also offer you our concerns. We pray for those names found in our prayers in the digital bulletin. We pray for those who are feeling scared or anxious at this time. Help them to not be afraid, to know they're loved. We pray for those who are sick, that they may be healed in whatever ways possible, mind, body, or spirit. We pray for those facing uncertain days as health declines and fails. Help them enjoy each day that they have. God, we pray for our community and for our world. We pray continued prayers for the people of Ukraine, especially near the cities of Kherson and Bakhmut, near the front lines, and pray for a just peace in the face of seemingly unending violence. Holy One, we pray for all the issues in our community and in our country still to be addressed, and praying that they may not be dismissed or ignored as inconvenient in timing, for racial justice, for the climate crisis, for income and wealth inequality, and for so many more things near and dear to our hearts. This time we offer those additional prayers, those names, those persons, those situations in our thoughts and on our hearts, and we offer them now to you in silence or aloud. Spirit of love, may you reveal your will in and through us, that we may live more fully as your disciples. Through Jesus our Christ we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Our scripture this morning comes from the book of Mark, chapter 13, verses 1 through 13. As he came out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what large stones and what large buildings." Then Jesus asked him, "Do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left here upon another. All will be thrown down." When he was sitting on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will this be? And what will be the sign that all these things are about to be accomplished?" Then Jesus began to say to them, "Beware that no one leads you astray. Many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and they will lead many astray. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. This must take place, but the fulfillment is still to come. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines, but this is but the beginning of the birth pains. As for yourselves, beware, for they will hand you over to councils, and you will be beaten in synagogues, and you will stand before governors and kings because of me, as a testimony to them. And the good news must first be proclaimed to all the nations. When they bring you to trial and hand you over, do not worry beforehand about what you are to say, but say whatever is given you at that time. For it is not you who speak, but the Holy Spirit. Sibling will betray sibling to death, and a father his child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all because of my name. But the one who endures to the fulfillment will be saved." This is our sacred story. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. The title for today's message is Discipleship in Difficult Times. As many of you might have noticed last week, I was absent from worship. I'm glad to be back. You might wonder, well, where was I? I attended and spoke at a conference organized by the Center for Process Studies and the Center for Open and Relational Theology. It was fun speaking there. I don't get the opportunity to give academic presentations all that often, but definitely one of the highlights was hearing from my favorite theologian, who was also there, Catherine Keller. I've mentioned her before. She's an ecofeminist process theologian. If you want to know what that means, we can talk sometime. Now, while at the conference, I purchased her latest book, which, by the way, has a lovely cover. I just love how it looks, called Facing Apocalypse, Climate, Democracy, and Other Last Chances. I read most of it on the flight back, just a few chapters left to go. It focuses on the apocalypse of John of Patmos, better known to us as the Book of Revelation. And in her book, she connects Revelation with contemporary, even equivalent challenges our world is facing now. As she helpfully reminds me, apocalypse does not mean the final destruction of the world. That might be how most of us hear it in its common usage. However, it literally means disclosure, as in lifting the veil. It's about revealing what is hidden, not necessarily as predicting the future, but rather exposing our current predicament. Along with another theologian I love, Ched Myers, she's helping me not just understand, but even affirm apocalyptic theology. It is less about triumphalism, certitude of victory, or nihilism at the futility of changing things. Instead, it is an invitation to engage in the struggle for a livable future despite the odds. It's about placing our faith in the divine possibility, the chance of something better. Certainly, that's a different angle than popular discourse of the apocalyptic as a predetermined future of destruction, of a warrior Jesus kicking butt and taking names. You'll certainly not hear any of that from me here today. But the book of Revelation is not the only instance of apocalyptic thinking in the Bible. There's also the latter half of Daniel, which is the earliest instance I'm aware of. And it just so happens that the scripture we heard this morning, one I selected well before that conference I attended, is part of what's called the little apocalypse in the Gospel of Mark. That comparatively brief little apocalypse takes up the entirety of chapter 13, of which we heard just the first part. Scholars have long debated its significance in the gospel. It almost interrupts the story. It puts a pause on the narrative as an interlude, transitioning from the end of Jesus' public ministry and his march to the cross. Even as there is extensive debate on its meaning, there is a broad consensus that it was written in one of the most significant events of the first century Palestine in mind. An event so impactful that it would fundamentally shape the future trajectories of both Judaism and Christianity. The event I'm referring to is the Jewish-Roman War from 66 to 70 of the Common Era. I confess, history can often feel cold, as if it's just a series of names, places, and dates. Looking after the fact, it can have a feeling of inevitability. But in the moment, people and communities have to make choices. The future was open and uncertain. We might feel that things are a bit unstable and in flux in our world today, yes? Well, that was just as true, if not even more so, in the time of Mark's community. While there's no way to be certain, for me, the biblical scholar Ched Myers makes a compelling case that the Gospel of Mark was not written immediately after the war's conclusion, but written right in the middle of it before its culmination. Less post-history, I told you so, or merely contemporary commentary, this passage served as instruction to the early church on how they should relate to the messianic revolution actively underway in their time and to the temple that revolt sought to protect. Should they, or should they not, join the rebels fighting against Roman efforts to reoccupy Palestine? Allow me to review how they got to that point. About two generations after Jesus' earthly ministry, just shy of 40 years, a revolt broke out in Palestine in June of 66, centered in Jerusalem. It was a long time coming, with decades of growing social dislocation, displacement from ancestral land, local banditry increasing among destitute peasants, until finally there was a breaking point. After suffering under corrupt and despotic Roman rule, sacrifices on behalf of the emperor at the temple were suspended. With that and the overthrow of the local Roman garrison, it was an act of war. The uprising spread quickly to neighboring provinces, and by that November, a Roman legion was marching on Jerusalem to put down the revolt. They tried to occupy the city, but were driven back and defeated. They retreated to the coast, asking Rome for help. There was euphoria in Jerusalem. It had been liberated from the tyrants of Rome. However, that feeling didn't last long. A provisional government was formed, but it was mired in internal power struggles bordering on civil war. Should they negotiate or not with Rome? Should the people in charge before the uprising retain their positions, or would there be a more egalitarian new order in place of it? While infighting went on in Jerusalem, Rome sent their top general, Vespasian, to crush the rebellion. He gathered troops and systematically marched through the Galilee region on the north, destroying villages, killing civilians, enslaving any survivors. Local guerrillas were defeated, and those who could fled back to Jerusalem behind its thick walls. By June of 68, Roman forces were ready to lay siege to Jerusalem once again. But then something else happened. Roman forces withdrew a second time, for Rome entered its own civil war with the death of Emperor Nero. The general Vespasian was summoned back, and he would eventually prevail and become the next emperor in that struggle. In the meantime, the uprising and resistance would get a reprieve of a year and a half. And it's likely that Mark's gospel is written in that time. Once again, it had appeared that God had intervened and saved Jerusalem, the holy city where the temple resided. Surely, this was the fulfillment of all God's promises to their people. The year 69 CE was a grace period, the final calm before the eventual storm. But things weren't stable even then. There had already been one internal civil war in Jerusalem around the high priest aristocracy. Once northern rebels fled to Jerusalem, the original government was overthrown, as well as the aristocracy and nobility. They were all removed from power. A commoner was put in charge as the high priest of the temple, and new fighting began between the priests and the more radical zealots. And not long after, there was a counter coup to the coup, with a three-way fight in Jerusalem over who was going to control the city and fight the Romans. There was Simon Bar Giora, who was the main leader and controlled most of Jerusalem, declared king by many as he overturned the zealot coalition, as well as John of Giscala and Eleazar ben Simon, who retained their own power bases in portions of the city. It was a mess. Only when Rome returned for the third siege in 70 did the factions finally set aside their own fighting and work together. This is the context in which Mark is writing. Amidst this instability, Mark writes from the perspective of the Galilean poor, who suffered both under the revolt and Roman reoccupation. The temple, located in Jerusalem, was the symbol of Jewish resistance. It inspired many. Its very design was meant to induce a feeling of God's presence. Covered in white stone with lots of plates of gold, it reflected the sun's very rays, so you couldn't even look at it like you were trying to catch a glimpse of the divine. But here in this gospel, Jesus faces opposite the temple and repudiates it. Verse 14, just beyond the passage we read, heavily hints that followers of Jesus should not flock to Jerusalem's defense, but instead flee to the hills. At its most critical hour, they should abandon it. For Mark's Jesus, the revolt is not the kingdom. The self-appointed rulers will not usher in the new messianic age. So Mark is in effect counter-recruiting, saying that alleged signs of divine intervention point not to the finale, but just the beginning. Instead of victorious triumphalism, he can only offer followers of Jesus suffering and tribulation. That's a hard sell. The revolutionary violence of liberation is contrasted with the revolutionary nonviolence of Jesus' way, the way of the sword or the way of the cross. Such non-cooperation with war inevitably leads to persecution, and we hear of the need to be on one's guard. Just as John and Jesus were handed over to authorities, Jesus' disciples should expect no better treatment. A stance of nonviolent resistance against the occupation will earn the wrath of local authorities, national authorities, and Roman invaders alike. As Myers writes, quote, "During the war, suspected rebels were routinely executed by Rome and suspected collaborators by the zealots. But just as the war does not herald the end but the beginning of suffering, so political persecution signals not the end but the beginning of the real discipleship mission." Unquote. this impossible situation eventually splits parts of the community and families as many are led astray by the lure of the promise of an imminent final confrontation with evil and guaranteed victory. In contrast, to remain on the way of Jesus is to be despised. The church's non-aligned radicalism left it between a rock and a hard place, receiving opposition from all sides. For historical equivalent, the best I could come up with is the Vietnamese Buddhist monk Thich Nhat Hanh. He died at the beginning of this year and eventually became well known as the second most famous Buddhist in the world after the Dalai Lama. But he lived through the Vietnam War, offering a persistent call for peace and giving a particular concern for the Vietnamese peasantry who felt the war's impacts more than any other single group. His nonviolent radicalism left him unpopular with U.S. officials, the National Liberation Front, the North Vietnamese Army, and the regime in South Vietnam. Like Mark's community, he too was eventually exiled, even as he was unwavering in his call for peace, despite that call being made illegal. This is very similar to the social location of Mark's community, Palestinian peasants suffering from and being seduced by forces beyond their control. The only comfort that can be offered for Mark here is to endure and be saved. But as has been indicated repeatedly, to save one's life is to be willing to lose it for the sake of the gospel. What does this have to do with us here and now? We are not living in an equivalent time of upheaval and uncertainty as Mark's community, nor Thich Nhat Hanh's. To say it's the same would be a gross simplification and flattening of real differences across time and history. Nor, might we say, do we expect those who chose to join Plymouth today to be ready to lay down their lives for the sake of the gospel. That was not one of the five questions we asked. If that was a prerequisite for membership, I think maybe some affirmations would be a little more hesitant. And not just for new members, but for existing members too, probably. That's not what most people are mentally signing up for when they become followers of Jesus. And yet, for those who hope that we are at the end of upheaval in our society, I have some news. Not necessarily a prediction of the future, but a reading of the times. We are not at the end, but as Mark says, merely the beginning of the birth pangs. We are not at a point of civil war, as some fear, but we should expect to see more strife in the months and years ahead. As Barbara Walter, an expert in international security and author of the book, How Civil Wars Start, says, we should expect more political violence in upcoming years. This includes potentially guerrilla fighting, targeting of civilians, even the bombing of religious centers. As scholars like Christopher Sebastian Parker have noted, white Americans are set to lose their majority status in another 22 years in the U.S., and we should expect to see increasingly open acts of white supremacist violence to maintain their current power. Ecologically, we're past the point of some unavoidable changes, and most of us will live to see a more unstable climate, with greater unnatural disasters, displacement of populations, and competition for dwindling resources. I don't think that's wildly pessimistic, but primarily descriptive of our current trajectory. There's more I could say about democracy in Indiana and the U.S., abortion rights, more pandemic pressures, but I'll leave it at that. I fear I've already pushed some of us past the point of what we might call threat saturation. In short, we are facing an apocalyptic moment, but not, mind you, in terms of a foregone end of the world, but rather as an unveiling, a disclosure, a revelation of the oppression, injustice, and intransigence of evil in our world. We don't choose the times in which we find ourselves. Mark's community certainly didn't. As much as we might lament that, I'm reminded, and take some encouragement by some of the most famous words from J.R.R. Tolkien's book, The Lord of the Rings, spoken by Gandalf. Some of you may be familiar with it. So do all who live to see such times, but that is not for them to decide. All we have to decide is what to do with the time that is given us. We can't control how things will turn out. The future's open. We always have a chance, a choice to live out. We can abandon efforts, giving in to nihilism or complacency. Like others, we can join the forces that accelerate and exacerbate downward spirals, making destructive prophecies almost self-fulfilling. Or we can choose the way of the cross, the way of compassion and love, not as a guarantee of victory, nor as an affirmation of necessary self-sacrifice, but as a risk, a wager, a statement in faith that Jesus' way is our way, that despite the hatred and fear, the oppression and threats around us, the pressure to pick a side and obliterate a seemingly irredeemable enemy, to that we say no. No, thank you. We will not give in to despair or to the denial of the dignity of others. Instead, we can demonstrate that God's hopes may yet be felt by the world and reciprocated in it. In so doing, we participate in another apocalypse, a different unveiling of God's will for us and to the radical, revolutionary, topsy-turvy Kairos kingdom seeking to be born in and through us. That promise of love, compassion, justice, and belonging is worth risking everything for. Our status, our position, our privilege, our securities in what is, letting it all pass away, knowing that the words of Jesus will not pass away. His way will not pass away. That someday, somehow, despite the evidence, our world will be able to hear the wisdom of that word. That as the old hymn the Apostle Paul quoted long ago says, that at the name given to Jesus, every knee should bend and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, not as a conquering victor or colonizing Christianity, but as an inspiration to others, showing all of us that his way of compassion and love is the way, truth, and life. This revelation tells us what it means to be disciples in hard times, that we can trust as those who have gone before have, and walk on the path as others do every day. In so doing, may we overcome the powers of evil through the power of God's love, banishing the ways and weapons of oppression for the way of peace. In such difficult times, now and in times to come, may we become the apocalypse against any world-ending apocalypse. May we reveal the good news in our living and giving. May we decide what kind of discipleship this time, this moment, this Kairos needs unveiling. May we walk in that way towards a path of abundant living for ourselves and all our world that it might enjoy someday. May it be so. Thanks be to God. Amen. As we prepare to conclude our service today, we heard this song in Espanol. Entonces una vez más, vamos a cantar a song. Number 173, You Have Come Down to the Lakeshore, verses 1-4 in English. So I invite all those who are able to stand and sing for our closing hymn. Number 173, You've Come Down to the Lakeshore.
Seeking neither the voice nor the
As you depart this space, keep watch and pray that the mind of Christ be in you, empowering you to disclose and reveal the way of compassion and justice. Be ever unwavering in your openness to the promise of God's love. May the Spirit move in and through you for the sake of the gospel. Go in peace. Amen.